Of course, thank you. Joining me now to discuss this is Democratic Congresswoman Tulsi Gabbard of Hawaii. She serves on the Armed Services and Foreign Affairs Committee in the House. She's also a major in the Army National Guard and did two tours of duty in the Middle East. Congresswoman, always good to see you. Do you have a better sense of what these soldiers were doing in Niger and why they didn't have the proper military support when they needed it?
Yeah, thanks, Jake. It's good to talk to you always. First of all, my heart goes out to the family members of our brothers who paid the ultimate price. There's an investigation that's going on. We should wait to get the details of that investigation rather than to speculate. But I can tell you that the question that I know that the American people are asking and that should be asked of this administration is, what are they doing in Niger? What is the objective that they are there to try to accomplish? What is the overall strategy in this so-called war on terror? On the one hand, we've got our young men and women who are putting their lives on the line for this country. We are spending taxpayer dollars in different parts of the world to support this war on terror. But on the other hand, we've got just a few months ago, the Trump administration doubling down on its partnership, on the United States partnership and alliance with countries like Saudi Arabia, who continue to be one of the biggest backers of these terrorist groups like ISIS and Al-Qaeda all around the world. So this contradiction is very clear to the American people, and this is the answer that we need to get from this administration is, what exactly is the strategy for this war on terror? What is our objective that we're trying to accomplish?
As somebody who has served, they were attacked by about 50 ISIS-affiliated fighters. Do you suspect that this may have been an intelligence failure in some way?
Yeah, again, I don't want to make any guesses or estimates about specifically what happened on the ground there. I think we owe it to our service members to actually just get the facts on the situation. But again, I think it's important for the American people, as well as a member of Congress, to hold the administration accountable to answer the larger question here of exactly what are we doing in Niger? Why are our soldiers, our service members on the ground there? And how does that fit into this quote-unquote war on terror that is contradictory to the administration's policy on Saudi Arabia? But also, if you look at the Trump's move just this past week to begin pulling out of the Iran nuclear deal, again, this is another part of this, is the Trump administration picking sides in this sectarian war that's been going on for so long between the Sunni faction, which is Saudi Arabia and others, and the Shia faction, which is Iran and other countries. All of these things have to be answered because it's very confusing.
Are you concerned that the U.S. is overextended with so many fighters all over the world, so many U.S. service members?
I am very much concerned about this and have been speaking out against our tradition, this history of American foreign policy that has led us to this place where we have spent trillions and trillions of dollars on these interventionist, counterproductive regime change wars. So many American lives have been lost. So many lives of people in these countries have been lost. And it's left us in a situation today where we have cash-strapped communities all across the country who don't have money for infrastructure. We've got, look at the situation in Puerto Rico, for example. You can look to the situation in Flint, Michigan with infrastructure. You can look at so many different examples of how we have paid the price for these decisions that have been made crossing different administrations, both Republican and Democrat, that have cost military, our service members, their families, and every single American across this country very much.
I want to ask you about North Korea. It's an issue of importance all over the United States, but especially perhaps in Hawaii, where you are right now and where you represent in Congress. The regime of Kim Jong-un threatened today that nuclear war with the United States could break out at any time. Now, North Korea has said it doesn't want diplomacy until it has a missile capable of reaching the United States. What should President Trump do?
You're right, Jake. This is a very real concern to the people of my home state of Hawaii, especially because of our proximity to North Korea and knowing that we are directly within range of their intercontinental ballistic missiles. So this nuclear threat is an existential one for us. Very simply, President Trump needs to engage directly with Kim Jong-un to find a peaceful diplomatic way to resolve this crisis. One of the major reasons why these negotiations have failed in the past is because there have always been these preconditions set that have frankly been a fantasy. They've not been realistic. To say, for example, that we will not negotiate or speak directly with North Korea until they get rid of their nuclear weapons program is a fantasy, because it points to the fact that we're not recognizing why North Korea has built this nuclear weapons program in the first place, to protect themselves from a threat from the United States of toppling their regime. So if we understand that our history of interventionist regime change policies have brought North Korea to this place of holding on to nuclear weapons as the only deterrent against regime change, mm-hmm. then we can begin to understand how important it is to have this direct conversation that will ultimately, could ultimately result in saving so many people's lives, what to speak of a massive war.
Democratic Congresswoman Tulsi Gabbard of Hawaii, always good to have you. Thank you so much.